John. Thanks very much. Mary, thank you very much. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to deliver this month's presentation at the Tipperary Historical Society. It is particularly pleasing for me to be back close to my roots, faded and all as they might be. It is great to see my compadres here from the Silver Mines Historical Society, and I apologise to them in advance for going over some of the ground they've heard before regarding the Kennedys of Polenorman. My presentation tonight is on Catholic landed gentry in 18th century Ireland, with an emphasis on Tipperary, which had a fairly good sprinkling of them, perhaps more than other counties, for reasons that we will explore as I go along. To use modern jargon, the 18th century was the most challenging period for Catholics, one of the most difficult they had faced, as the reins of power were firmly held by a Protestant Parliament. I am, of course, referring to the Penal Laws, which cast long shadows on Catholic landed people who were perhaps the most affected by them. The first few facts about the 18th century, as it's called by historians, the long 18th century. It was a century of relative peace for over nine decades. Indeed, one of the longest periods without wars, which contributed to much development. The landscape, as we now know it, is a product of that era, when cities and towns developed and expanded. Some of our finest public buildings, like courthouses and custom houses, were built during the 1700s. Horizons were widened with new roads and canals, while ditches and walls were constructed to divide landholdings. And to crown it all, there was a building boom, which is a curse or a blessing, depending on how you see it. And this building boom saw the country peppered with Georgian mansions, and the most beautiful Georgian streetscapes in our cities. Can you hear me?
Yes.
That's working. I'm never sure about this. Of course, most of this work was carried out by the Protestant ascendancy or the Anglo-Irish, while most of the old Catholic landed families grimly held on to what they had. And that was no mean feat in a society that prohibited them from taking public office or even voting for Parliament. Gaelic culture and language were being systematically eroded, and a new order was taking over. Attitudes to trade, class and external influences changed over the century. And what was left of the Catholic landed gentry emerged very different into the next century, into the 1800s. And that is what my talk about is tonight, what happened during the 1700s. But perhaps that is how it is after any century has passed. Just look at ourselves versus our grandparents or great-grandparents 100 years ago tonight. Things do change in 100 years. Now, my presentation is mainly based on research into contemporary family papers and estate records. Now, Terence Dooley, I'm sure many of you are familiar with him from Maynooth College. Terence Dooley says the only accurate way of doing most research, particularly into families, is into estate records, estate papers, and I think that would agree with him there. Now, the family papers of the Ryans of Inch, in fact, they were located in this building for several years after the Ryan family had sold Inch House and moved on. And now, of course, they're in the Boo Library of University College in Cork, and I had a lot of access to them when I was doing my dissertation. Now, they're a most valuable primary source of original material from a Catholic landed family in Tipperary. They're perhaps one of the most valuable in the country. Other primary sources that I used were the family papers of the Latin Mansfields of County Kildare, again, and also of the Bellews of Mount Bellew in County Galway. Both of these were not only Catholic families, but they were intermarried very much with the Tipperary Catholic gentry, both the Latins, you'll see this as we go along. Some of you probably know this already anyway. And these are some of the aspects that I'll cover during my talk. I'd be delighted with your questions and comments after I have delivered my spiel. I have no doubt that many of you know much more about some of these families than I do, and I'd be delighted to hear more about them. And I would also ask that you switch off your mobiles and the like during the talk. And I'll answer any of your questions that I'm able to, and if I can't, well, I'll do a runner out the underground passage afterwards. Now, my first slide there is the Battle of Aucrim in July of 1691. And the Battle of Aucrim really is what cast a long shadow over all Catholic landed families during the 1700s. And basically, as you know, the Battle of Arkham was fought by the Williamites and the Jacobites. They were the followers of King James and King William, both of whom, King James, of course, had been King of England, and he was deposed in 1689 or thereabouts because his wife, his young wife, who was Catholic, and he was also Catholic, had given birth to a baby boy, to the consternation of the Protestant population of England and Ireland. So there were so what happened then was that James's son-in-law, King, he was William the Shadholder, William of Orange, who was married to James's daughter Mary, was invited to take the English. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, he was invited back to. Hold on, we've lost it. Are you back? Yeah.
He was invited to.
Sorry. Thanks, John. So, as I was saying, King William and his wife Mary were invited back to take the throne of England. I think I'm still getting it out. John, I think you're back still up here. And, okay. Might be easier.
As I was saying to you folks, is that on?
Yeah.
King William and, I'll say this about five more times, King William and, sorry, William of Orange and his wife Mary were invited back to take the throne of England, and of course a war, and so it's kind of known in England as the Glorious Revolution, and so well it might be because very little activity took place on English soil during that so-called Glorious Revolution. Most of the battles took place in Ireland, including the Battle of the Boyne, and of course there was the defeat of the Williamites of Limerick, but of course ultimately it was the Battle of Arkham was the last war, and the Battle of Arkham was where the Williamites, where the Jacobites were defeated by the Williamites at Arkham in July of 1691. And as I said to you, the reason I have it there is that was to cast a long shadow into the 1700s, particularly on the Irish Catholic land gentry. Of course, the Treaty of Limerick followed the Battle of Arkham, and you know the rest, and we'll be going through it anyway. Now, the Catholic landed class, of course, had seen their boats rise in the brief time of the Jacobite supremacy. That was why King James was King of England between for the two or three years he was King of England, the late 1680s. He was Catholic, of course, his wife was Catholic, and the main man in Ireland during that period was Richard Talbot, the Earl of Tyrconnell, who was of the Talbot family of Malahide, that I'll be talking about later on when they come into this talk. Not because I lived there, but because it happened to. And so Richard Talbot, the Earl of Tyrconnell, who was a Catholic, was the main man in Ireland during that period of Jacobite supremacy. Of course, during the Jacobite supremacy, the Catholics saw their boats rise and they thought that things are good, things are getting a lot better. However, after Arkham, they were defeated, and insecurity. And one word can sum up the 18th century, it's insecurity on both sides. And the Protestant landowning class, of course, who had, as the Catholics were coming into to favour during the brief reign of James II, they began to see themselves losing the lands that they got to the previous in the plantations and so on earlier in that century. So the result, of course, of the Protestants was they introduced the Penal Code. The Penal Laws were in that, and you cannot talk about Catholics, Catholic landed or Catholic anything else in the 18th century without reference to the Penal Code. The Penal Code were a set of laws, there weren't one code, there were a lot of different laws that were introduced at different times in about a 10 or 12 year period between 1693 and 1705. Now, in 1690, or just around the time of the Boyne and before the defeat of Arkham, the Catholic land ownership was about 22% of the population. The restrictions on Catholic landholding was introduced after 1703. The Land Acts, or the Penal Laws affecting land, kicked into force on the 1st of January 1704. Basically, under the Penal Code on land, Catholics could not buy land, Catholics could not inherit land from Protestants. Catholic fathers had to bequeath the land equally to sons, unless one was a Protestant, and then he inherited the lot. and Catholics could not lease land for more than 31 years. That is what the law, what the statute book said, or the law said. However, it did not work quite like that. If you had leases taken out before 1704, those leases remained intact. They were not taken from you. But the Ryans of Venture are a great example. They had leases taken out forever and a day from the Matthews family. And they held those leases after 1703. There was no great difficulty with them. Now, just to say one thing, and this is very important to say, regarding the 18th century or the 1700s, the importance of land ownership cannot be overstressed. Ian MacBride, the historian, has written a lot about the 18th century, says that more than any other form of wealth or political office, land and property offered the best security for invested capital and it conferred social prestige. And bear the last phrase in mind, social prestige, because the 18th century was a century of social prestige, and it's not really, if you like, it's more common word for it, but it's the same thing. 18th century gentry, I have no idea who they are. They were got from the internet and they look good. They might be from Tipperary, or perish the thought, they could be from Kilkenny, I don't know. Now, after 1703, as I said, the penal laws on land came into effect after 1703. About 14% of the land was still in Catholic hands. Bear in mind, the 22% there 13 years previously in 1690, around the time of the Battle of the Boyne. And they still have 14%, so we're not looking at a great loss, really. And there are reasons for the losses as well. Now, this is important to bear in mind. And I sounded like a schoolmaster now, saying this. I was never a schoolmaster. I was a revenue official, but that's another matter. And maybe it's worse. And the pattern of landholding was determined by 17th century plantations, by the combined plantation and the other plantations that took place during the 17th century, not by the 18th century, not by the penal laws. In fact, little land was lost over the penal laws, but not a hell of a whole lot. Some people lost after the Treaty of Limerick, but they were like the Richard Talbots. And his wife fought it in court for years and years afterwards. It was a large estate out in Luke. Now, most of the land that was lost by Catholics after the Williamite Wars and after the penal laws on land came into force can be attributed to emigration. Quite a few people left the country, went to France, particularly Spain and so on, and Austria. After the Treaty of Limerick, the lands were lost. Quite a few families conformed. In North Tipperary, I will be going to some who did become Protestant. One great example, of course, is the O'Carrolls. Another small land of gentry near the Sullivan Mines, I'm saying this because I'm from that area, where the park workers, they had conformed, but very early on in the early 1700s. They were part of the old O'Carrolls of Ely, and they had become Protestant very early on. Conforming, and sales of estates. And sales of estates occur quite a bit during the 18th century, and you'll see this as we go on. Now, the Tipperary Catholic landed gentry included, now there's probably more than I don't have here, included the Matthews families. As you know, the Matthews are very much associated with where we are at, with Thurles. The Matthews grandmother, she was Lady Thurles, she was planted, and we talk about them later on in connection with the Duke of Ormond. Have I lost it again, John?
No, I haven't. I found it.
Oh, did you? He has found it.
Good man yourself. That's great. Oh Jesus, that's not fair. Anyway, there were the Matthews families. Okay, there were several Matthews families. There were the Ryans of Inch, the Morreses of Latteragh, Kennedys of Polenorman, the Daltons of Grenanstown, Tommy Varia, and the Egans of Annameadle, again that's near Tommy Varia, isn't it? Now, there were people who held land, they were the land owners. Now, you cannot forget either during that century, quite a lot of families held land on the leases. Many Catholics had large land holdings, though they were not necessarily the owners. Now, for example, the MacCarthys of Springfield in Tipperary, near Tipperary Town, leased 10,000 acres which is far more than the Ryans of Inch had, far more than the Morres at 2,500 in Latteragh, and the Kennedys at 2,000 in Polenorman, and so on. But the MacCarthys had 10,000 acres leased from the Duke of Ormond. The MacCarthys were connected with the Duke of Ormond, I might add, and the Duke of Ormond, I will have to go into a little bit more about him in a while, but the Duke of Ormond's mother remained Catholic. She was Lady Thurles. Duke of Ormond's mother, his father was drowned off Ceres, or was off Malahide, or somewhere like that anyway, somewhere off North Dublin coast. And his mother remarried Mr. Matthews, and she was Lady Thurles. And the Duke of Ormond was one of the few members of that family to become Protestant. He had to be sent to England under the legislation at the time. He had to be sent to England to be educated. He was educated and reared in the house of Archbishop Stone, an Anglican bishop or a Church of England bishop in London, and he remained a Protestant throughout his life and a very committed Protestant. However, most of his family, including his mother, were Catholic. And so the Matthews family are that closely connected to the Duke of Ormond. A sister of his was married to the Earl of Muskerry, and the MacCarthys are the same family as the Earl of Muskerry. That's how they come to be connected with the Butlers or the Dukes of Ormond, and leasing the 10,000 acres. They are quite close family. The MacCarthy holding was described by Arthur Young. Most of you have heard of Arthur Young, the famous English traveller, who wrote extensively about Ireland. He travelled around the country in 1776, and he described the MacCarthy holding in Springhouse as one of the most considerable in the world, which is no mean feat. I think his world was only Ireland, England and France, so not sure it went much further. Now, a lot of you will be familiar with Kilshane House Hotel. Kilshane House Hotel is built close to the old MacCarthy of Springhouse residence. It is not the same house, I understand. This dates from the early 1800s. I think the MacCarthys had left at that stage. Now, to go on to the Penal Code. The Penal Code, of course, apart from land, there was all the other stuff as well in the Penal Code. Number one was Catholics, everybody was required to take the oath of supremacy and to acknowledge the king as the spiritual leader, as the leader of the church. Mass was not allowed. Tithes had to be collected from everybody, irrespective of their religion, to support the Protestant clergy. And one priest to a parish, and exile of Catholic bishops were to be exiled. Formal education was prohibited for Catholics. Trinity College, they were banned from Trinity College, but that happened up to relatively recently. They were also banned from the professions. Intermarriage was forbidden between Catholics and Protestants. No, the Catholics did not have a vote, as I said earlier, did not have a vote in parliamentary elections. They could not hold political or military offices. They were not allowed to hold guns or weapons. No horse could not hold have a horse worth more than £5. Now, that is all what is down on paper. The real question is, did they adhere to this? And the answer is some of bits and pieces of it, which we shall hit as we go along. So I would ask the question, with all these obstacles, how did the Catholic landed gentry survive? And the answer, of course, is with some difficulty, as they kept their heads down and got on with the business of trying to maintain their social level as much as possible. And to go back to what I said at the beginning, social level was very important. Now, historians argue that 18th century Catholic landed gentry in Tipperary survived thanks to the Duke of Ormond. And this is true to an extent. The Duke of Ormond, of course, became Lord Lieutenant after the Restoration in 1660, and he had the giving or taking of all those people who lost their lands in the plantations, applied to get their lands back under all those that thought that legislation at the time. Most of them didn't. And the Duke of Ormond was the person with the final say. However, if you were connected with the Duke of Ormond, you stood a very good chance of getting your land back. The Matthews family all had their lands. They might have lost them, but certainly got them back. The Ryans of Inch lost their lands. They were in County Clare for quite a while, but they were intermarried with the Matthews all over the place, and they got their lands back, and maybe a little bit more. The Morrises, or the Demarisco family of Latteragh, got back far more than they lost, because they were closely connected with the Duke of Ormond. He had the giving or the taking of the land. The giving or the not giving of the taking was taken already. That's James Butler, the Duke of Ormond. I told you about him. He was Protestant while most of his family remained Catholic. Now, other Catholic families survived in different ways. Now, the Kennedys of Polenorman, that's near Dala, that's near Sultanwise, they managed to increase their holding from around 200 acres after the plantations in the 1650s to about 2,000 acres in the early 1700s. Before the Penal Laws kicked in, the Kennedys of Polenorman owned around 2,000 acres. And they got it because they were lawyers and so on. They worked for some of the new settlers who came in. And by all sorts of means, I'm not sure a lot of them were totally legal, isn't the word to use, but whatever. But they managed to get 2,000 acres of land. And it reminds me in many ways of the recent recession. That during all periods like that, some people actually make money. You know, a lot lose, but there are others who are crafty enough to see ways out of it. Kennedys of Polenorman managed to do that during a very difficult time for their people like them. The Catholic Daltons of Grenanstown are a most interesting family. They seem to have been granted land in the plantations, even though they were Catholic, and they held on to it basically by keeping the heads down. They didn't do very much during that period, but they were intermarrying with the old other Catholic families, particularly the MacCarthys and the Ryans of Inch and so on. Now, as I was saying to you, the William I IV arose because of the two kings, William of Orange and the other guy, James II. Now, the real difficulty for the Irish Catholic landed gentry during the 1700s, their hope and their purse was the Jacobite court in exile. That's James II in exile, the court of James II, the Stuart court in exile. Initially, the Stuart court was based at Saint-Germain-en-Laye in Paris. After the defeat of the French by the British at the Peace of Utrecht, or one of those, the English insisted that the French no longer support the Stuart king in exile. So the Pope bankrolled them from there on, and they moved to Rome, where they were supported by the Pope until they eventually died out. But the real difficulty for the Irish Catholic landed gentry was that the papacy still supported the pretender's right to nominate bishops to vacant Irish sees. So when a bishopric became vacant, Bishop of Cork, Clyde, Cashel, wherever, the pretender, the Stuart king in exile, had the right to nominate the successor to that see, which was a real thorn in the side of the Protestants, of the government in Ireland. Here you have the king in exile, or the pretender, as they were called. Now, I'm never quite sure why they called the pretender. I mean, they probably had as much right as the guy who was on the throne. But nevertheless, they're called the pretender, and they had the right to nominate bishops to Irish sees, which was a real difficulty. And this was a thorn in the side of the Protestant state until the death of the last Stuart. The last Stuart died in 1766. In fact, he was a priest or a cardinal or something in the church anyway, that the bunny Prince Charlie had died some years before that. He was the baby boy, believe it or not, that all the problem was about when William of Orange was invited to take up the throne of England. That's the old pretender, James Charles Edward Stuart. He's the old pretender, and this is his son, the bunny prince. Bunny Prince Charlie, and we'll be talking about him later on because he features quite a bit. Now, you can see the difficulty there is at the time, that you have the Stuarts in exile who have certain rights, like to nominate bishops to Irish sees. There are the English crown and the government in place here wants to forget about them. They're gone. But they won't go away, really. They're still around, and they have still have certain powers. Now, the Protestant insecurity was also compounded by many, many Catholic Irish Catholic gentry in the European armies, because they would have gone after the Treaty of Limerick. Now, Maureen Ball, great historian, says that when rumours reached Ireland that a French fleet with the pretender on board was heading for the Irish coast, new laws would be passed to safeguard still further the Protestant ascendancy. That's as is. Now, at such times of crisis, prominent Catholic noblemen were rounded up where possible and interrogated. Now, this was particularly so in the summer of 1714, as Queen Anne was about to die. Queen Anne, of course, succeeded William and Mary, and she was married. She had about 24 children, none of whom survived, but she didn't have any heir. And, of course, the Protestant heir was her cousin. It was George of Hanover, who became George I of England. And the House of Hanover was about to succeed. She was dying at that stage. And the Jacobites, of course, the Jacobites, the Stuarts in exile, the Pretenders, were watching and plotting to see what was going to happen when Queen Anne died. In fact, the Pretender, that guy James, the old Pretender, was invited back to take the throne of England, provided he became Protestant, but he refused. And also there had been a change of government, the Tories had got out of power, a new Whig government had brought in sweeping changes in political office. In fact, there was a period of great uncertainty there. Does it remind you of anything? Because all of these changes are about to happen. A new king is about to take over on Friday, and a new Whig government has come into power, and the Whig government did so many sweeping changes, in fact, they dismissed everyone in public office, including, I said, down to the lowest gardener in Trinity College. You know, they went down that far and put in their own people. The others were Tory supporters and have been put there. If any of you ever read the life of Mrs. Delaney, she was a person in the 1700s who was really affected by her father lost, what if he had some job at court and he lost it, and she was forced into a marriage with a man of about 55, a lot younger than me, but nevertheless, she was only 16. So as all this uncertainty is brewing, the Jacobite ranks were swelling in Scotland, and also the Duke of Ormond, the current Duke of Ormond, jumped ship as well and joined the Jacobites. He went over to England. The Pretender had come on board, had come to Scotland, and there certainly was an uprising. Now, arms and horses of Catholics were seized. Now, bear in mind, they weren't supposed to have arms. They were holding them, nevertheless. Horses, they were not supposed to have gone over £5. So if you go below £5, it's probably eugenic. I'm not quite sure. But it's not an equal thoroughbred anyway. So, but still, they were having horses over £5. So there are two of the penal laws kind of knocked out the window already. Horses over £5 or under £5 and the not holding arms. Now, George Matthew and his son-in-law, George Matthew Thurles, and his son-in-law, John Ryan of Inch House, were both lodged in Clonmel jail. Now, after several months, Mr. Ryan was released on the grounds that he was sick and that he was no threat to the state. But at that time, Ireland's Catholics were not in a position to do very much. The Scots, on the other hand, were moving. The Jacobite rebellion in Scotland, and as I said, the numbers increased, and it ended in defeat at the battle. They were defeated at the Battle of Sheriffmuir in 1715. Now, the Irish Catholic gentry could now get on with the business of living until the next Jacobite threat, and they would be under threat again. Where am I? Sorry, I jumped ship there myself. I'm going to end this. Now we get back to it. It's all right. I hit the wrong one. I hit the end, I think. Yeah, I was at the Battle of Sheriffmuir, yeah. The Battle of Sheriffmuir, where the Jacobites were defeated in 1715. Now, the insecurity of the Catholic landed gentry in Ireland saw them operate in very tightly knit communities of very close friendships. Now, this is particularly illustrated in the will of John Ryan of Inch in the Ryan papers, the Ryan of Inch papers. John Ryan died in 1723, and according to research recently, he died in a duel over land. And I didn't come across that, but there's a young man doing a PhD in Maynooth at the moment who has come up with this. When he died in 1723, he was, of course, married to a Matthews. His eldest son and heir, Daniel, was only 5 or 6 years of age. The executors to his will were my father-in-law, Major George Matthews of Thurles, Howard Egan of Annameadle, Esquire, and Hugh Kennedy of Polenorman, Gent. I'm not quite sure what the difference between an Esquire and a Gent is, but obviously to Mr. Ryan in his will, or to his legal advisor, there was some difference. Inch House, which you're all familiar with, and of course, there are the Ryans of Inch, who lived up there up to the last 30 years ago or thereabouts, didn't it? And Annfield, which was one of the Matthews castles. Now, Basically, what the Ryan papers reveal is that Kennedy and Egan were extremely attentive to their duties. And really why I'm saying this is that it just shows that the Catholic landed gentry were very, very tightly knit community. They looked after each other. Hugh Kennedy, in October 1725, wrote to John Ryan's widow, and he was very ill at the time, and he said he would get the best price for her livestock, either in money, he wasn't a great speller, or good Dublin bills. That's not my misspelling, instead. It's Mr. Kennedy. The poor man is long dead, but he was suffering from some disease at the time. Egan's will, now later on Mr. Egan died, and his will revealed substantial, enormous wealth actually, and it's in the Ryan papers, and he bequeathed my other silver mounted screw barrel pistol to my cousin Daniel Ryan of Inch. Here we go again. Here is another one of the penal laws. They're not supposed to have any arms. However, he bequeaths his not only an ordinary pistol, but one with a silver mount or whatever. Now, this, of course, raises issues on the accepted narrative of the penal laws. Now, as early as 1705, that's 2 years after the land, the main land acts came into play, John Kennedy of Polenorman, he had been a Jacobite officer in the regiment of Black James Morres. I don't know why he was called Black James Morres, but he was. I don't think he was coloured, but I mean, he was a Morres of Latteragh. And John Kennedy of Polenorman was in his regiment. And John Kennedy was one of the 8 Tipperary papers licensed to carry arms. That was in 1705, even though the law had been kicked in a year or two before that, but he was allowed to carry arms. Why, I have no idea. And it's a very interesting question as to why. In 1776, Arthur Young observed, regarding the penal laws, do not seem to me so much level at the religion, but the property that is found in the religion, which is an interesting call. A friend of mine did say, Paddy, it all goes back to the moolah. And in this case, it all goes back to the land of the acres. The Catholic gentry and ascendancy, now the next question is, how did the Catholic gentry and all these ascendancy neighbours, how did they get on? And all the evidence points to the fact that they got on quite well. Now, for example, in the Ryan of Inch papers, there was very, very close friendship between them and Mr. Amias Bush of Kilfane House, who was the High Sheriff of County Kilkenny. Now, I feel Mr. Bush was related to them in some way, or Mr. Bush, of course, was High Sheriff, he was also Protestant. Bush was involved in a lot of things with the Ryans. You'll find him cropping up in the Ryan. Anybody who looks at the Ryan papers would find Mr. Amias Bush all over the place. And he was a witness to the marriage articles, as the marriage, the what they now refer to in Hollywood as the prenup, between Daniel Ryan of Inch when he married Elizabeth MacCarthys of Springfield in 1737. That's Kilfane House in Thomastown. It was sold quite recently, and that's taken, of course, from the website, at the sale of Kilfane House, which was Mr. Amias Bush's residence in near Thomastown. He got a beautiful house in County Kilkenny. And one of the things I won't apologise for, because I can't help the fact that photography was only was invented in the late 1800s, that when on presentations in the 1700s, I'll be showing you a lot of houses and a lot of ruins and wrecks of same, because we don't have pictures of very few people, not unless they have their portraits done. Now, again, I've been talking about the friendship between the Catholic landed gentry and their ascendancy neighbours. The Denali papers, the Dalies of Kilboy, near Dalla, show that they're a very close friendship with the Catholic Daltons of Grenanstown. And this, of course, the Daltons were spread out to the MacCarthys and the Ryes were intermarried among them. Now, Karen Harvey, who has written an excellent book on the Belliers of Montbellier, she's a historian, the Belliers of Montbellier in County Galway, the Belliers were not a Catholic family, claims that the willingness of Protestant neighbours to hold land in trust was a key factor in sustaining a Catholic gentry. So, help from Protestant neighbours was very much available to many Catholics who were friendly with their ascendancy of Protestant neighbours. And the Ryan of Inch papers particularly sold out. Any of you who have read Grace's card by Charles Trench, he lived in County Tipperary, I think, he claims that part of the Ryan holding was held by them because of the influence of Mr. Bush, the High Sheriff of Kilkenny. Now, that's Kilboy, the Dudley seat, and it's been rebuilt. It's, of course, owned by the Ryan family, now the late Tony Ryan of Guinness Pete. It's been rebuilt back to, who was the people from the silver mines here? It's gone back to the original, isn't it? Betty or whoever there. It's been rebuilt back. It was in the last couple. There was a big fire there, and it was remodeled. And that's Grenanstown, the Dalton residence near Tony Power. So as I was saying, the Denellys or the Pretties and the Grenanstown Daltons were quite friendly. Now, remember one of the penal laws, intermarriage was forbidden between Catholics and Protestants. In fact, according to most historians, it took place at every social level. Now, Dorothea Herbert, as you many of you read her book, was the daughter of the rector of Carrickmacshire in New Inn. And in her book, she recounts how one of her father's curates married a Catholic. And she wrote, "The Catholics made a great sputter about it, but everyone thought we were a lucky woman to get him. But Dorothea Herbert wouldn't she?" As Mandy Rice David said, when Dorothea Herbert gave her whole book, her whole aim in life was to get a husband, which unfortunately didn't happen for her. But she would have thought this girl was very lucky. Leave aside the religion, not of interest to me. All she was interested in was a husband. Dorothea Herbert's retrospections. Now, another aspect of the penal laws, of course, which really affected the Catholic land and gentry, was the prohibition of formal education. Now, there is no indication in the Ryan papers of where Daniel Ryan's heir, John Ryan, was educated, but his second son, George, at the age of 9, was sent to Spain to a MacCarthy aunt who was married in Spain, and he was educated in Spain, and he later secured a commission in the Spanish army, and he spent quite a lot of his about 10 or more years in Peru in the Spanish army. Dennis, the youngest Ryan brother, there were three brothers in that family. There was John, George, wasn't it? Yeah, and Dennis. Dennis was the youngest, and he was educated somewhere in Europe because he spent his life in the Imperial Austrian Army. And he was based in the area that's around Belgium now. Now, there is no reference to any education for the four daughters. But however, I was at a lecture not very long ago by this girl who's doing a PhD in UCD, and it was on the Latins of Morrestown. I'll be talking about them in a little while, because they're connected with all of these families. And the Latin daughters were all educated in Bordeaux. And in fact, one of them used to escape out over the wall, and she subsequently married a man who became the mayor of Bordeaux. She did well, didn't she? And I don't know. But she didn't spend all her time in education. And the Ryans of Inch, of course, had close family relations in France with all those McCarthys. In 1775, a traveller, Thomas Campbell, he was a travel writer, visited the MacCarthys at Springhouse. Everybody seems to visit the MacCarthys at Springhouse. Arthur Young was there the following year. And he wrote, "The eldest daughter is married to a colonel in the Imperial Austrian service, and the eldest son is an officer in the same service." And that probably accounts for the fact that a lot of the Ryans of Inch, because they were their own uncles and aunts and so on, ended up in the Imperial Austrian Army, because the MacCarthys were there already. There was a tradition in that family. I think you had a talk here last year on, I meant to come down to it, yeah. It was on the Ryans of Inch, wasn't it, and the Austrian Army. Yeah. Yeah. I couldn't find them actually. I searched the Ryan papers. I could not find any reference to them, but that doesn't mean anything. You know, she could be right, and I don't know. Now, despite the prohibition on education, and that girl from UCD and myself and many others, I've rooted the place to find any evidence of prosecutions of Catholics for educating their families abroad, and we could find none. Absolutely none. She and I went through this, and there was none we could find. But however, it was of course a cruel imposition. You look at that young man, young George Ryan, going to Spain at the age of 9, like, it's cruel. But of course, this happened in England, didn't it? Send the kids to prep schools or whatever, 7 or 8 years of age. We were lucky not to have been born to the aristocracy. But it was a cruel imposition. As Andrew French wrote in 1767, on the birth of Michael Bellius, and these are the Bellius of Montpellier, and they were to be educated in France and Spain, he said, "God help us papists. We must part our native lands or bear with daily insults." That sounds very dramatic. I'm not quite sure exactly what it means. But basically what it means is that they've got to go abroad for their education. That's Mount Bellew, where the Bellews live. I believe it's Agricultural College now, County Galway. It's nice, isn't it? Go back there. Yeah, I just got it off the website, obviously. I'm not familiar with it, but I thought it looked good too. Now, so basically, the enforcement of most of the penal code was impossible and largely ignored. Now, a Protestant lawyer witnessed Mr. Egan's will. I said to you about Mr. Egan bequeathing a certain amount of pistol to Daniel Ryan Finch, my dear cousin, and bequeathed a firearm to Catholic Daniel Ryan. And Brian Murphy, a historian who's written extensively about Waterford, concludes that in Ireland the laws were designed to repress the majority of the population. There just wasn't forces there to do it. They didn't have the enforcement. No, they're not people there, as opposed to a minority, like the Huguenots in France, they were the minority there, and likewise the Catholics in England, again, there were minorities. In Ireland, you're repressing the majority. Now, for the Catholic landed gentry, the first two decades of the 18th century were the most difficult, and as Karen Harvey describes, they lived lives of accommodation and frustration. That's how children brought to be educated to keep their heads down, shut their mouths, just get on with it. They were living in a Protestant state and put up with it. However, after Culloden, the Battle of Culloden in 1745, this eased somewhat. Now, for example, in the 1750s, Dr. James Buckler, the Archbishop of Cashel, which this diocese is in, this town is in, he was freely visiting over 50 outlying parishes of the Diocese of Cashel. Some of you probably read Archbishop Buckler's journal or his diaries during the 1750s when he visited all these outlying parishes. Most of these parishes had a chapel, despite the fact that there was to be no chapels. They had a resident priest or priests, a school and a teacher who was required to teach the catechism. And in Archbishop Buckler's, or Bishop Buckler, was he Bishop or Archbishop? Was he Archbishop? Was Cashel's an Archbishop? Bishop, yeah. Well, in his journal, there are various notes there. Paddy Ryan, teacher at Killascully, ordered to the bishop's house next Sunday to explain why he wasn't teaching enough catechism. So not only were they teaching catechism, but he was actually checking it to see what they were doing. The Bishop Buckler ordained priests. Also, on his travels around the diocese, he ordained priests who would later travel to Europe to be further educated. And a lot of these went to the Catholic University of Louvain in Belgium. And the reason that Bishop Buckler would have ordained those priests on his travels was because when they went to Louvain or wherever they went for their further education, they were in a position to actually earn money by saying masses and doing stuff like doing priestly duties that you got paid for that would subsidise their education abroad. In fact, Michael Ryan, who's down there in the audience, tells of two of his relatives from Upper Church, isn't Michael, who were educated in France or somewhere, their PhDs in the late 1700s, they came from Upper Church. So, you know, this was common enough. There is little evidence that the Catholic Church was forced to operate underground. Bishop Buckler would say that they had a church, and he would describe the church. The churches weren't palatial buildings, far from it. They were fairly crude enough structures. However, there were churches where people could hear Mass. In the 1764 deed of sale for the Kennedy of Polenorman estate, it was sold in 1764 to the Protestant Going family, and it provides the sale excluded the chapel at Ballandigny or the chapel at Killeen, where Pat and Teresa and all my relatives are from down there, and a little land that went with the church. So, again, there was nothing underground in this transfer. It was a legal document carried out by legal people, and the church, the chapel, was excluded from it. Now, for most of the 18th century, matters were reasonably settled, but they could flare at any time. And you had that the laws were on the statute books, they could flare. And it happened in County Cork in 1743 and 1745. Now, these are incidents that have been recorded. Other stuff might have happened that wasn't recorded. But these were, particularly in Cork in 1743, when the soldiers from the garrison desecrated the Catholic chapel in a very religious mixed community of the town of Youghal. Likewise, the Mallow militia extorted cash from Catholics to purchase new uniforms. They didn't have much choice but give it to them. They were the militia. And it is no coincidence this was during the last great Jacobite resurgence, that culminated at the Battle of Culloden in 1745. After that, people would say if all began to ease down. The Jacobites are defeated, the Bonnie Prince is not going to rise again, he's one of the men or the power, so they're kind of fading away. This Culloden, 1746 rather, and don't ask me to name them, again this is got from the internet. Now, of course, as I said, the laws could flare at any time, and this county of Tipperary saw an appalling trail of events that led to the execution of Father Sheehy as late as 1766, that's 20 years after Culloden. This highlighted both racial and sectarian conflict. And it concerned the white boys, the election of a member of the Matthews family to Parliament, Mr. Matthew had confirmed he was Protestant at that stage, and it was the bigotry of Lord Howarden of Dundrum House, really, that caused all that. However, that being said, Father Sheehy had friends as well, particularly the Viscountess Moore, the guy in out there in a care, what do you call it, village, where Ronald Reagan went to. Ballycorrin, yeah, is that the name of that house? Liz Moore, Cahill, yeah. Sean Ballycastle, yeah. He warned Father Sheehy, get up, Father Sheehy wouldn't go. And anyway, that's the poor man was executed for something he shouldn't have been. Clonmel Courthouse, just to bring it back, but this is where Father Sheehy was executed, was sentenced to execution anyway. Now, what were the people of the 18th century like? What were the Catholic aristocracy like, the Catholic landed gentry? Now, research shows that 18th century aristocracy, they recognised two kinds of people in the world, the people who are them and the common people. So there's us, who are the, there's you and there's me. The people and the common people. And this goes back again to the class, the class structure. Class consciousness was very much a part of that society. A very unequal society where power and wealth were monopolised by a very small group. Now, the same was true all over contemporary Western Europe. Look at France at the same time. France was Catholic. It was a Catholic country, the king was Catholic. But again, there was the people, who were the aristocracy, and there was the commoners who paid the taxes and did all the other stuff that the revenue looked after. Now, Louis Cullen, who wrote the introduction to, in the latest edition of Dorothy Herbert's book, The Retrospections, says that 18th century Ireland was every bit as obsessed as Jane Austen's Hampshire or England with connections and birth. So, class and birth were what it was all about. A petition by Cork gentlemen putting forward a candidate for the Catholic Bishop of Cloyne and Ross stated, this is the petition, and this is in the Stuart papers, actually, that's where it comes from. His ancestors had never degenerated by following any vile or mechanical profession. They didn't have shops, they weren't undertakers, there were nothing vile. But they have always, certainly didn't work for the revenue, and have always lived in a decent and credible manner in the farming way, like other Roman Catholic gentlemen following the forfeiture of their estates. Obviously they lost their estates in the 1600s during the Cromwellian plantation. But the point to going to Rome was, he's not common, he's not whatever it is, there's the common. And back again to those gentry with the lovely dresses and whatever, and the gentleman on horseback who looks as if he owns the world, probably does. Now, an interesting question about the Catholic landed gentry is how they ran their estates and how did they treat their workers and their tenants? Did they treat them much differently to the ascendancy, to the Protestant ascendancy people? And the evidence suggests there was very little difference between them and their ascendancy neighbours. Now, one of the best set of estate ledgers of the 1700s in the country, in the National Library in Dublin, is the Otway Papers from Castle Otway near Templederry. And there are ledgers there of the workers, and the spalpeens, and the tenants, and the whole lot, going back right through the 70s, from 1772 up to 1785. And also in the National Library are the papers of the Catholic Bellies of Mount Bellew in County Galway. Now, one's Catholic, the other's very much Protestant. I've looked through both, there is very little difference. There is hardly no difference between them, because they were all fining their tenants for being late for work, for not doing what they were supposed to be doing, or whatever. But there was no difference really between them. And if there was any difference between them, the Ryans eventually would have had 5 million people living out at Inch. They would have left all the other estates in Tipperary. Did any of them? During the 50 years of the Otway Papers, I looked at three people left the estate. And maybe there was nowhere else to go. But certainly their Catholic landed neighbours were no better. That is the point, really. 18th century Irish cottiers. Unfortunate. And that's Castle Otway near Temple Derry, which of course was burned down during the it was burned down in 1922. Now, basically, the Ryans of Inch, the land of gentry, and their like, had much less in common with their co-religionist tenants, cottiers, and spalpeens than they had with their Protestant neighbours. MacBride, I see MacBride, a historian, states, Protestants, Catholics, and dissenters might worship in different churches, but nevertheless they inhabited the same social world. If you were of a certain class, you were of that class, religion. Yeah. The only real difference between them was where they worshipped. Now, George Ryan of Inch House was in Toulouse at the time of the French Revolution. He did a runner from Ireland because the family were in lot of debt, and it was quite easy, it was easier to live abroad. He thought he would live abroad much cheaper, and he was living in Toulouse at the time. And he wrote home to his father-in-law, and we're talking Mr. Roach of Limerick, we'll talk of him in a moment. And he says, one thing to the credit of the mob, that is those who rebelled in France, the rebels, is that there was never a drunken person to be seen among them. How different from our Irish mobility, whose knuckles are generally on the itch for a whack at their next neighbour's right or wrong. I'm pretty certain that there is more blood spilt at a gingerbread pattern in Ireland than there has been all over France since the commencement of the revolution. Things were to change, and change drastically later on during the Reign of Terror. I don't think any Irish fair or gingerbread pattern would match what happened there. The storming of the Bastille, just to remind us, is France, and it's the storming of the Bastille, which was one of the events at the earlier part of the revolution. Now, most of the Ryans of Inch, of course, not all of these people had family living abroad. The Ryans of Inch travelled extensively all over France, where they had MacCarthy relatives that prospered in both Toulouse and Bordeaux. The MacCarthys were heavily involved in the wine trade in Bordeaux, actually. The MacCarthy Library in Toulouse was one of the most famous in Europe when it was sold in the early 1800s. A MacCarthy emigrated from Springhouse in Tipperary, emigrated to France in 1764. His wife was a French from County Galway, and they were collected with the values and all that Galway milieu. And he died in France. His son continued living there, and was his library was one of the most famous in Europe. And Dennis MacCarthy was appointed the director of the Chambre de Commerce in Bordeaux in 1767. Great going near Bordeaux, just to remind you where you could go on your holidays. And an 18th century building. The MacCarthys didn't live there, but not far from it, because it's one of the finest houses in Bordeaux, it seems. Now, one of the really interesting parts of the Catholic land of gentry of the 18th century is their marriage patterns. And they reflected, basically they reflected society that was beginning to change a lot. Now, at the beginning of the 18th century, the Ryans of Inch, and they're the papers really that, you know, there's most stuff in. The others, there's no papers really of the Daltons of Grenanstown. There are no papers there for a lot of the others. They may be there, but I haven't laid my hands on them. The Ryans of Inch married Matthews, Moore Matthews, and the MacCarthys of Springhouse. John Ryan, who died in 1723, was married to Francis Matthew. That's the guy I told you was killed in a duel, probably. Shot by a Mr. White from Lucan or Leixlip or somewhere overland. And his son Daniel in 1736 married Elizabeth MacCarthy of Springhouse. Elizabeth MacCarthy had a dowry of, I think it was £1,500. Daniel's heir John married Mary Kennedy of Polenorman. And Mary Kennedy of Polenorman, her mother had sold the estate in Polenorman the Protestant going family in 1764. Immediately after that sale of that land to Mr. Going, Mary Kennedy married John Ryan of Inch. She came with a very large handbag, and there was a lot of money at that stage. And her mother was Christiana Lawton of Morristown in County Kildare. and the Latins were an old English Catholic family. They had extensive lands around Newbridge and also around Carrick and Shore. And they were intermarried with many Catholic families within the area of Leinster, within the Pale, the Latins of Morristown. And this Morristown Latin County Kildare is close to Newbridge. And that couple, I believe, who bought Little Dell House, Cassidy's, that is one of their houses now. That's their second home, the one to pay the second tax on. Summer House or Winter House, this Adele being the other one. Dennis MacCarthy of Springhouse was married to Christina French, of Galway. And the French, of course, Galway were connected to Bellews. So basically what I'm saying here is that you have the Tipperary gentry, they're intermarrying with the Leinster gentry, the Latins of Morristown, who again were connected all over the place, and they're also marrying in to the Connacht Catholic families as well. So the web of Tipperary gentry was extended to Catholic landowners of Connacht, like the Bellews of Mount Bellew, of course, who were intermarried with the Frenches. Now, Sir Patrick, I thought I couldn't leave this out. Sir Patrick Bellew of Mount Bellew, his attitude to trade is captured in a letter to a relative. And he was referring to the marriage of one of the members of the family who married the daughter of a Dublin seed merchant. And he lamented, "I confess my pride suffers a little on account of the alliance." He could have done better, basically. And their common, their trade. highlights the class consciousness. But all Catholic gentry did not feel the same about trade as Sir Patrick Bellew. Roy Foster, the historian who retired there recently, claims that the large Catholic monopoly of trade, a lot of Catholics went into trade, and again that's an interesting aspect as well, it resulted not only from their exclusion, because they couldn't buy land, so a lot of them went from acquiring land and property, but also because of the ascendancy's contempt for trade. So the contempt for trade was working on both sides. The early 1800s, the Catholics began to see this the only way forward for us, get into trade, particularly when they couldn't buy land. And David Dixon, who was the authority on 18th century idea in Trinity College, David Dixon, he's done a lot of papers on this, and he says only those with money actually got into trade. So you couldn't just go in and buy ships or whatever, you know, and you needed money to start. The poor certainly weren't getting into trade, even if they were Catholic. But much 50% of the requirements, but they needed the moolah as well. Now, the Ryans of Inch did not seem to have any aversion to marrying into trade. By the mid-18th century, Daniel Ryan's daughters were certainly marrying into merchant families. Francis Ryan married Walter Wolfe of Carrick and Shore. The Wolfe family of Carrick and Shore ran a wine business. And Walter Wolfe's diary, if any of you ever have time or are interested, go to the National Library and read Walter Wolfe's letters. There's a letter book of Walter Wolfe's there. He was supplying wine to everybody, probably all your relations. And he knows what the old among them, so on and so on. And he had a very large, wide circle of customers. So one of the Ryans of Inch was married to Mr. Wolfe. A sister was married into the merchant family, the Harrods of Cork, who were shepherds. And but a third, of course, married to the old Reliables, one of the Matthews, a cousin of hers. Now, the wealthiest and most powerful Waterford shipping company, Wise, Cash and Quam, also had close connections with the Tipperary Catholic gentry. John MacCarthy of Springhouse was married to a Wise girl, and she had a dowry of something like 15,000, not to be refused. And a niece of John Ryan's wife, that's Mary Kennedy of Polenorman, her niece, she was a forester, she was Alicia Forrester, she married Mr. Quan of the same company. And Richard Power, who's written on his thesis for his PhD, on 18th century Tipperary, wrote that these marriage connections tied the Tipperary Catholic families into a far-flung network of mercantile links with Catholics overseas, especially to the port of Waterford, as they had said, the MacCarthys and the Ryan connection there were marrying into the Waterford shipping families. Now, one of the most interesting people in the Ryan of Inch paper, and I finished the Ryan papers because my dissertation finished at 1800, one of the most interesting of the characters there is George Ryan. George Ryan was sent to Spain to be educated at the age of 9. He was with the MacCarthy aunt in Spain, Dona Maria. She was married to someone first, and then she married a real Spaniard afterwards. I think she was married to an Irish man first. And George Ryan went into the Spanish army, and he went to Peru, where he spent 10 years. However, his brother died very young, under the age of 40. He was the guy who had Inch House at the time. He was married to Mary Kennedy of Polenorman. He died in 1778, and George inherited. It took them about 6 or 8 months to track him down in Peru, where he was with the Spanish army. Come home, you have got a lot of money. You have inherited the family estate. When he came home, he discovered the family estate had a lot of debts. And one of the things he wrote on was, "I came home to discover a lot of debts and 7 screeching widows on my back." There was his brother's widow and all these other widows who all drew money from the estate, and they were all looking for their money. So George Ryan had to marry, and he had to marry money immediately, as soon as he could. 3 years later, he married Mary Ann Roach of the Limerick Shipping Company, the Roaches of Limerick. And Maureen Wall, the historian, writes, "The Roaches were among the richest merchants in the south of Ireland. They had built an enormous warehouse on the quays of Limerick and had their own ships mounted with guns for the West Indian trade." So the Roaches were a very wealthy family. Although the Inch estate now was very encumbered with debt when George Ryan inherited, he received a dowry of £5,000, a colossal amount of money at the time, with his bride Mary Ann Roach. Her dowry was the same as Maria Trant, who married Lord Denali 20 years later, and Lord Denali was one of the most powerful figures in the Tipperary ascendancy, with an income of £10,000 a year. The Ryan of Inch estate was £1,500 a year, but still, the Roaches wanted to marry up, and they saw by marrying the Ryans of Inch, they were going up the social scale. This was the same all over Europe, incidentally, at the same time. Ireland is no different in many ways to the rest of Europe. In France, the very same thing was happening. Merchant shipping families in Bordeaux were marrying into the French aristocracy, who were delighted to have them, not so much because they were merchant families, but because they had a nice bit of money coming with them. 18th century Limerick, that's the market house in Limerick in the 18th century. In 1778, the most severe restrictions on Catholics leasing and inheriting land were removed. Remember my earlier slide there about the restrictions on land that kicked in 1704. So it was only those who took the oath of allegiance were allowed to benefit. And between 1778 and, say, in a 3-year period there, and 1791, Count Christopher Dalton and Peter Dalton of Grenanstown took the oath, as did Thomas MacCarthy of Springhouse and George and Dennis Ryan of Inch. They all had to go to Clonmel to take the oath. And I was a youngster in Tipperary going to Clonmel with different connotations. But in fact, in this case, it was to take the oath. Now, the Morres estate of Latteragh was sold to the Earl of Orkney around about 1750. The Kennedy estate of Polenorman, as I said to you earlier, was sold when the lovely Mary married to John Ryan of Inch in 1764, and it was sold to the Protestant Goings. Likewise, the Earl of Orkney, of course, is Protestant. The widowed Mrs. Christian Kennedy, 2 daughters, the eldest Mary I've told you about, she married John Ryan of Inch, and the other daughter, Alice, married Edmund Forrester of Rochestown in County Kilkenny. They were an old Catholic family, very much connected with the Butlers of Ormond, and Rochestown is not very far from Waterford. Because when I came across this in the Ryan papers, I was looking all over County Cork for Rochestown, not realising it was in Kilkenny. Where is it? Is it? The Wise? The Shippers? That's the Wise Cashin and Paul, yeah. That's how Tipperary, I thought it was Kilkenny. Oh, was it? Where was it?
It's on the river, just next down from here.
Oh, right, okay.
It's about 4 miles down
from
here.
Oh, well, thanks very much. I thought it was Kilkenny. Thanks. Now, the Kennedys die out of they're gone from the Tipperary Catholic landed gentry in 1764. They're not heritage again, even though they're in. Mary Kennedy, who married John Ryan of Inch, did not have any family. He died very young, and there was no children of the marriage. She did not remarry. She died in Waterford about 30 years later. Her sister, of course, married Forrester, and she had quite a lot. She had 6 or 7 children. So the line did continue. Some of the Morres family conformed. Certainly, there was some of them become Protestant there, the Morres family of Latteragh. as did some of the Egans of Annameadle. Religion was fluid. For several of the old Catholic landed, like they became Protestant easy, you will find quite a few members of families becoming Protestant, like the Egans are a particular example of it, and also the Morreses. A lot of the Morreses remained Catholic. The Matthew family included both Catholic and Protestant. As you know, like Father Matthew is of the same family, isn't he? He would be descended from the same stock as the Duke of Ormond. Yeah, and Annameadle, yeah, her grandmother was a Matthews, wasn't it? Yeah. The Ryan of Inch family papers indicate that many of the family felt more English. So if you look at the Ryan papers, and pick up their letters and the journals, as the journal attributed to John Ryan in the 1770s, and reading that, John Ryan feels far more English than he does Irish, because he was in England. He was extolling the beauty of the countryside around Bath, and he said in his journal, if there is to be a heaven, I would hope it is somewhere close to Bath. Well, to each their own. And as soon as the prohibition was lifted, the sons of Catholic gentry, many sons of Catholic, all of them, of course, joined the British Army. Now, when rebellion came, and rebellion was always around the corner, the 98th rebellion came, very few Catholic landed gentry were involved in it. One notable exception, of course, in Tipperary was Harvey Morres of the Latteragh family. He was very active in the Nina area, where he recruited many United Irishmen. And of course, as you know, vicious reprisals were taken on those who were involved, the United Irishmen. And Harvey Morres was the main recruiter. There were two of the leaders of the United Irishmen, the 98th Rebellion, Wolfetone and Lord Edward Fitzgerald. And Harvey Morres was a great friend of Lord Edward's. Harvey Morres managed to escape Ireland. He got away, but he was later arrested in Hamburg. He was brought back to Dublin, where he was tried along with Knapertandy. Knapertandy was a merchant of Capel Street, and Knapertandy was opposed to everything, really, but he got heavily involved in the 98th Rebellion. And he was tried for treason along with Harvey Morres, but they were both acquitted on a technicality, and one of the conditions of the acquittal was that they leave ASAP. And Morres seems to have ended his days in the French army. He was of the same Catholic branch. He was Catholic of the same Catholic branch. I told you some of them had become Protestant. They were also called Montmorency. A member of that family settled in Malahide. And this takes me home. Morres married Susanna Talbot. Remember I said to you earlier about Richard Talbot, the Earl of Tyrconnell? Susanna Talbot would be a direct descendant of his. And they built Sea Park House in Malahide, which is very close, if you know Malahide, it's very close to the Grand Hotel. And a daughter of theirs married the heir to the Gaelic, to the Maguires of Fermanagh, married back into the old Gaelic. The Maguires of Fermanagh were connected with the O'Neills and the O'Donnells. That's Sea Park House in Malahide. It's built now, it's knocked down now by 20 years or so, Michael, isn't it? Yeah, and a lot of lovely apartments are built there. They cost lovely money, and it's known as the Sycamores. So, I think Sycamores, isn't it?
Yes.
Or something like that. The Laurels or something. Yeah. It's trees, anyway. Now, just to conclude, it would seem that the Penal Laws had succeeded where they wanted to. And basically, what the Penal Laws wanted to do was, of course, restrict the ownership of land, and by and large, they did. By and large, also, Catholic gentry seem to have become more anglicised. If the Ryan papers are to be believed, and the Bellews as well, it would seem they had become quite a bit more anglicised, and maybe it's just a century evolving. During the next century, when the Young Ireland movement blossomed, prominent in its ranks, now we're looking at the 1848, prominent in its ranks were the descendants of several Tipperary Catholic gentry. Thomas Francis Marr was directly descended from the Kennedys of Polenorman. His great-grandmother was a Kennedy. She was a sister of Mrs. Ryan of Inch. And Richard Alton Williams, he was involved in the Young Ireland, he was the poet, of course, the guy who wrote the Monster Vale of the Brothel and all that lovely stuff. And he was of the Dalton family of Grenanstown. That's Thomas Francis Marr there. He was, of course, a colonel in the American Army. He was governor of Montana, and yeah, you know the rest. And that's Richard Dalton William, who also went to the States. I think he died in New Orleans. He was a medical doctor. And finally, the long 18th century ended with far less of the old Catholic gentry left in County Tipperary. The Morreses of Latteragh, the Kennedys of Polenorman, and the Egans of Annameadle had all disappeared during the century. But a new body of strong Catholic farmers and merchants were beginning to take their places and also to take over lands of the old families. There you have it, folks. Thank you very much.